fix it and look after it. So we have to think medium to long term. And that's why I'm trying to give you the challenges that I see in the medium to long term that Dr. Wagar and the others in the planning division have to take on with your input. Now, let me go back to the question I asked earlier. What is buzz coming in? What? Let's address the first question. What range of employment must we create in order to employ these conditions in the neighborhoods? Well, the World Bank, the Asian Development Bank, and a number of other organizations in the last few years have been doing economic reports for the different provinces. And we've been working out the elasticity of employment with respect to GDP growth. And in all the provinces, I think about many variations. 7% a year just employ the emissions increase. And if you are thinking of employing the unemployed of the past or of reducing the underemployed, then you need a growth rate of 8%, perhaps even higher. But if you need 7 just to employ the real wage, if you need 7% growth just to employ the new additions to the labor force, then you would need 8 or 8 plus to make a dent into the ranks of the unemployed, of the already unemployed, and to reduce the rate of underemployment. So, let's begin with that. Now, the experience of all the countries in the world that I looked at, and for 8 years I was responsible, sorry, for 10 years I was responsible for the so-called East Asian Tiger countries, the World Bank, I was responsible for lending the economic policy dialogue with these countries, Korea, Thailand, Philippines, Malaysia, Vietnam, so on. And if you look at the South Asia, South American countries also, Brazil, Chile, and the other parts going on, they all have investment rates of about 25% of GDP at least. The ratio of investment to GDP is about 35% or more. And as Dr. Bagar pointed out, I mean, the China's, Pakistan's is less than 20. Pakistan's investment rate is less than 50. So, obviously, we have to do something if we are going to meet our challenges. Let's take a look at what is Pakistan's potential rate of growth. And there are different ways of measuring the potential rate of growth. One way is the trend rate over the last 20, 25, 30 years and say, well, this is pretty much what we'll be able to do over the future. Another way is to look at the growth of the labor force and at the growth of productivity and add the two together and say that gives us the potential rate of growth. And then there are various more sophisticated econometric exercises that one can do. And which I don't discourage anyone from doing, but given the quality of our data, I would not raise excessive belief. But if you rough measures of the potential rate of growth, it comes out to about 5.5%. Now, if we need a minimum of 7, and we can only do 5.5, then clearly we have a problem, because we are going to add to our employment. And that's so the next question logically that comes is, how can you increase the potential rate of growth? How can you raise it? Now the potential rate of growth depends largely on two factors. One is the rate of investment. And the other is the strength and quality of institutions. So when I say that Pakistan's potential rate of growth is 5.5%, what I mean is that it's a given level of and distribution of investment, given level and competition of the government, and the given institutions, much the most we can do. We can have a square foot above it, square foot below it. But as a trend, 5.5 is about what we're getting. If you're able to raise this, the logical things to do are raise the rate of investment and strengthen the institutions, provide incentives for productivity that will enable us to have a higher potential and also squeeze more growth out of productivity increases. Squeeze more growth out of any given level of interest. This is really what the new development strategy aims to do. It aims to make higher investment more attractive by removing the obstacles that face investment, that increase the cost of doing business in profit. We have some of the benefits of our as we talked about. You remove the zoning laws in some cities, you remove one of the obstacles to commercialization, and you remove one of the, and you provide a greater incentive to invest similarly, if you free up markets, you again increase the profitability of investment, and you again make it possible for an entrepreneur to say, I'm going to invest more over here. That essentially is, you know, the these two things, raise investment, raise investment, more productive. These are the two aims, right, of the new development strategy. Now, I just want to say a word or two about the importance of productivity. Because remember, we were talking about our having to outcompete our neighbors if we are going to survive in this rough world. The measurements of productivity in Pakistan, the long-term measurements of productivity in Pakistan, show that between 1970 and 2005, productivity increases in Pakistan accounted for about 50% of the increase in per capita. They accounted for about 30% of the increase in GDP in India and in East Asian tigers. So both these other places are using their inputs much more efficiently than we are. So here obviously is an area where development strategy has to focus. That's why are we not doing
it? Well, British businessmen were stuck with the Rolls Royce because it was so expensive that recouping the cost of it was going to take 15 or 20 years. So by the time it was profitable for the Englishman to replace the machine, the American already had had 3 or 4 advances in technological progress embodied in his machines. So American productivity kept increasing, whereas British productivity remained low. And this is shown up very clearly in the differences in labor productivity. You can remember those years, 1860 to 1914, 1918. Labor was a scarce factor, both in England and in the United States. So the point I'm making is that you can't get away from physical investment because that's what embodies the advances in technology. I mean, advance in technology is no use to the economy if it sits in a patient on a shelf. It has to be embodied in physical capital. But how do you get the incentive to invest in that machine, actually buy that machine and get it working, and then to extract the most from it? This depends a lot on institutions, markets, and other factors that Dr. Vazar has been talking about. So, and the reason I intervened over here was to put the discussion in some kind of perspective that where does the new development strategy fit in? Why do we need it? Why is it urgent? And why do we need the collective inputs of everybody over here to make these ideas more practical, to make these ideas gel with it? One last mark. I mean, when you ask questions later, and I mean when Dr. Bakar goes back and thinks of the sitting office and thinks of the answers and thinks about developing the work, etc., he might want, and you might want, to ask yourself at least a couple of questions in addition to whatever else. One is that why has India's investment rate gone
I don't know. I'd be fascinated to know the answer.
But why is their savings rate and their investment rate? Their savings rate is twice ours and their investment rate is 50% higher than ours. Why? But they face the same trouble. The second is that in the slides that were put up, infrastructure was not bad compared to here. We were talking about physical infrastructure. We didn't have any slide up there about human resource infrastructure. How do we compare school? How do we compare education? I mean, it's great that we have roads that are good as Indians and Chinese, but I'd really like to know whether we have schools that are good as Indians and Chinese. I mean, again, I don't know the answer. I'm just tossing these out as questions for reflection. And I do thank you for your indulgence in allowing me to intervene over here, because this is really not my show. It's a show of people sitting around over here. Thank you very much.